So good evening, eminent doctor. On the behalf of HealthNU, I welcome you for webinar on epilepsy management. This webinar is a digital initiative by HealthNU, Dizzy Neuro, digital initiative by Dizzy Neuro, HealthNU. The topics for today is newer therapy approach in epilepsy management and psychiatry aspect of epilepsy. HealthNU always believe in innovation. We have few brands, but all brand have some uniqueness which can meet the unmet medical need. So initially we have launched Brinda, that is a bevacizumab 25 mg, 50 mg, 75 and 100 mg tablet. So the uniqueness in this Brinda is we have launched a digital app, Ask Brinda app, for the benefit of patient. In that, patient can manage the seizure diary. There will be pill reminder, there will be visit reminder. So a lot of features this Ask Brinda app is having. So the uniqueness is this app. Our flagship brand is Amnurite, that is a combination of amitriptyline 5 mg, 10 mg, 25 mg, along with mecobalamin 1500 microgram. The uniqueness is combination and also 5 mg of amitriptyline, which is not there with any brand. So it gives a wide range to prescribe from 5 mg starting to 10 and 25 mg. Also in major depressive disorder, Amnurite 25 mg. We have for migraine with comorbid condition, Amnurite Beta. Again, it's a uniqueness, this combination, amitriptyline 5 mg, 10 mg along with propranolol 20 and 40 mg in ER form. Apart from Amnurite, our innovation is Brentamine. This is a combination of riboflavin 200 mg, magnesium 200 mg, and CoQ10 mg for migraine in pregnancy, lactation, adults and migraine, and old age migraine, where the conventional therapy cannot be written. Again, one innovation, widely prescribed naproxen and domperidone, but the problem is naproxen dissolution profile is very, very poor. So in NDRAP, what we have done, we have covered naproxen with rapid acting particle. And within 30 minutes, 99% of naproxen dissolve and provide rapid relief to your patient. So we always believe in some innovation. Add clobaz, clobazam was there in the market, but 2.5 mg was missing. So we have seen that gap and we have launched add clobaz 2.5 mg in mouth dissolving mango flavor. So for up titration and down titration of the dose, add clobaz 2.5 mg is very, very useful. We also have add clobaz 5 mg and 10 mg. Since last year, we have done more than 50 webinars, and this webinars is uploaded on the Dizzy Neuro channel. And total more than 525 subscribers are there. 57 webinars we have done, total 66 speaker from eminent speaker from India, and 11 speaker we have got from abroad, and total doctor has participated 11,000. So webinar, this Dizzy Neuro channel is available on YouTube, and please visit and please subscribe. Let me take this opportunity and pleasure to introduce moderator of this webinar, Dr. Sonal Shukla Madam. She is a consultant psychiatrist and also the director of Postgraduate Institute of Behavioral and Medical Sciences, Raipur. I request Madam to introduce the speaker.
Yes, thank you, sir. So I would like to welcome Dr. P.N. Shukla, sir, and Dr. Shripal Shaile Shah, sir. So firstly, a brief introduction of Dr. Shukla, sir. He's a consultant psychiatrist in Postgraduate Institute, Raipur. He's also the founder and director of the same. He's an enthusiastic educationalist and as a visionary and already saw the dearth in the field of psychiatry. So this institute is in picture today. He's practicing as a consultant psychiatrist since 1980 at Raipur, running a 100-bedded psychiatry nursing home in Manabasti, Raipur since 1998. He was the president of Indian Psychiatry Society Central Zone in the year 2003 and 6 as well. He was the ex-president of IME in 1990. He was awarded BB Sethi Oration Award in 2007 in for Indian Psychiatry Society Central Zone. He was a member of Executive Counseling of IPS for 2 years, member of Advisory Committee of Indian Journal of Psychiatry, and has got many international and national paper publication in the field of psychiatry. And Dr. Shripal Shailesh Shah sir, he has done his MD and DM neurology from Bangalore and also FINR from Pune. He has the fellowship of international interventional neuroradiology from KEM Pune, also interventional neurology and stroke specialist at Arihant Neuro Center Nashik. Worked at NIMHANS Bangalore and the Department of Neurology, member of Society of Vascular and Interventional Neurology USA, also member of American Academy of Neurology. He is also a member of Indian Stroke Association, participated in more than 10 clinical trials, and has got many international and national paper publication in the field of neurology. Dr. Shripal Sheikh is the first and only interventional neurologist in North Maharashtra and one of very few neurologists in India who are formally trained in performing this procedure. So this was the brief introduction of both the speakers. And so I would like to give the further session to Dr. Shukla, sir. Thank you.
Would I have to talk first?
I think, okay. Yeah, fir, let us clear with...
I think let Dr. Shah first talk about
okay.
His...
Okay.
And then I'll follow that.
Okay. Welcome, sir. Dr. Shah, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Thanks, Health and You, for giving this opportunity and to discuss about newer therapies in the management of epilepsy. I'll just share my screen. Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible, yes,
sir. Yeah, I'll just... So today what I'm going to highlight is newer therapy approach in epilepsy management. And the more time I'm going to spend on the newer hero of anti-epileptic drugs, which is brevetracetam, which has just come into the market. So epilepsy and anti-epileptic drugs. Anti-epileptic drugs play a central, crucial role in treatment of epilepsy patients, and majority of the patients are on these drugs for a longer period of time. But our problem is that 30% of patients are refractory to medical treatment, and there are always a newer therapeutic options which are necessary. So in last 50-60 years, there were three generations of anti-epileptic drugs. First generation, second, and the newer third generations, which have arrived, which have come in a span of last 10 years. So classification of AEDs, as we see, the first generation of drugs, which I think Shukla sir, everyone has used in their practice since long period of time, with pinch of all side effects are like phenytoin, phenobarbitone, carbamazepine, sodium valproate, and clonazepam. They were still the most wonderful drugs which were available and used in practice, but they came with lots of side effects. But seizure control was very good with these drugs. But later on, there were second generation of drugs which were introduced. And the second generation, what we commonly use in practice, are levetiracetam, oxcarbamazepine, lamotrigine, and topiramate. Sometimes we are using vigabatrin and gabapentin, but these were the second generation of drugs. Now, after the second generation, the third generation of drugs, which came in last 7 to 10 years, were lacosamide, perampanel, rufinamide, fosphenytoin, brevetracetam, and eslicarbamazepine. Now, why these generation of drugs have come and why they were required? Most of the drugs which were required were in complex, partial, or focal onset epilepsy, as a add-on drugs or as a first-line drugs. Now, when first generation of drugs were there, side effect profile were quite high with these drugs, and long-term benefits did not outweigh the side effect profile. So there was dearth of drugs, and second generation anti-epileptic drugs came into the market. Even with second anti-epileptic drugs, still there was not very good control except on carbamazepine, lamotrigine, and levetiracetam, which were add-on drug initially used, and later on third generation of drugs came. We are still not using rufinamide. Esli carbamazepine is out of the market. So hardly we have fosphenytoin, definitely is a pro or isomer or pro drug of phenytoin, which we are using. But brivetracetam and lacosamide and perampanel, these were the drugs which have come into the market, and they are as an add-on drug which have recently come, and we are using since 5 to 7 years. But brivetracetam is just launched, and I think we got to discuss about this drug also. Now, why so many anti-epileptic drugs are there, and why it is necessary to understand key, what is problem with all the drugs and what are advantages and disadvantages. So we go into the mechanism of action. So mostly those which are on the acting on the sodium channel blockers, like inactivation of sodium channels, are phenytoin, carbamazepine, valproate, lamotrigine, topiramate, zonisamide, and lacosamide. Most of the older drugs act on the sodium channels. Okay. Then glutamatergic excitatory inhibitors were phenobarbital, phenytoin, valproate, levetiracetam, lacosamide. So they reduce the activity of GABA, AMPA, and NMDA receptors. So these were used to reduce the excitotoxicity of these neurotransmitters. Then, which were the facilitators of GABA-mediated chloride channel opening were phenobarbitones, valproates, and benzodiazepines. So all had different actions, but you can see there were some of these older generation drugs which had broad spectrum of activity, like phenytoin, carbamazepine, and valproate and lamotrigine. Usually they act on all these channels and help for inhibition. But T-type calcium current inhibition were what? Valproate, zonisamide, and ethosuximide. Levetiracetam acts on L-type calcium channel. Now, why we were discussing about older generation of drugs were because of their side effects. With phenote, I'll not go into much because I think Shukla sir will discuss about cognitive and psychiatric side effects of these drugs. But what I want to highlight is phenobarbital, we have seen sedation, depression, hyperactivity. These were seen with phenobarbital. Phenytoin, again, what commonly we see in practice with phenytoin, very commonly, is gingival hyperplasia. Secondly, if we are not giving folic acid supplementation, they develop megaloblastic anemias. Then even what it has not been mentioned about, if calcium supplementation is not there with carbamazepine and phenytoin, elderly age group, if they are on these drugs, they may develop mostly osteoporotic features also with phenytoin and carbamazepine. One of my relative had recently developed severe osteoporosis with carbamazepine dose 1200 milligram for mesial temporal sclerosis. So these were the side effects. Then hepatotoxicity also, and lupus-like reactions. Again, oxcarbamazepine or carbamazepine, very common side effects. What we see is hyponatremia. So all these drugs, like P450 acting drugs, or phenobarbital, phenytoin, carbamazepine group, in elderly population, if we are using, we definitely have to watch all these side effects. And lamotrigine, definitely skin reactions and Stevens-Johnson syndrome, very common. Again, topiramate we used in migraine also, plus in epilepsy as an add-on. Commonly we see is, because it is a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, paresthesias we see, acidosis, weight loss, calculi, glaucomas. So again, we are using zonisamide and topiramate with definitely monitoring these drugs. Now, drugs which are lower down are with lesser side effects, like levetiracetam, wonderful drug. Only one side effect what we are seeing very commonly is cognitive abnormalities and irritability. Second most side effect which I face across after like operating aneurysms or AVMs, I am seeing hair loss is very common with levetiracetam. I don't know, sir, you agree or not, but hair loss is alopecia. I have seen with levetiracetam also.
Complete baldness I have seen.
Baldness, yeah, complete baldness I have seen with levetiracetam. Again, lacosamide, very few side effects, but dizziness, nausea is common with lacosamide. And clobazam, sedation. Perampanel, they have mentioned about dizziness and mood changes. I have not used perampanel or ficompo in my practice. So I think very less of experience I do have in regarding perampanel. So I think why newer drugs were required was ki older generation of drugs were very good, but more side effects.
Right.
Middle second generation drug, better, lesser side effects, but effectivity was 50-50. They require or they were used as add-on. And still there is scope of newer drugs which are used in partial onset or JMEs or idiopathic generalized epilepsy. So I think we go to the newer drug, which is the highlight, is a brivetracetam. Newer member designed selectively to target SV2A with binding affinity, which is 15 to 30 fold greater than levetiracetam. Why this is important? SV2A belongs to synaptic vesicle protein family. It's brain specific. It is an integral membrane protein present in all vesicles. And the synaptic vesicles, as we know, are filled with neurotransmitters and release it when calcium enters the terminals. So it controls the release of neurotransmitter. So if I go into brivetracetam, this is the synaptic vesicles and SV2A. I'm not going into much of the pathophysiology, but I just want to highlight ki SV2A vesicle is there and brivetracetam enters synaptic vesicles and selectively it has very high affinity for this protein, SV2A protein, and with a binding which is 15 to 30 times higher than levetiracetam. And this helps in reducing the transmission, reducing the increase in the neurotransmission, and when calcium enters, sodium again has to, when calcium is entering, sodium has to go out. So excitatory transmission is reduced and does not show modulatory activity at AMPA receptors, but selectively it is used for SV2A. Now, this is one slide which I just got from somewhere when I was reviewing, and this is very interesting. What are the advantages of brivetracetam on the older AEDs and over newer AEDs? So when we see on this side, we are discussing about the dose, 50 to 200 milligram is the dose, and what are the advantages? It does, as per the older generation drugs, here we do not require therapeutic dose monitoring as older generation drugs used to require. Half-life is 9 hours. Steady state in plasma for 2 days. It can remain steady for 2 days. No erratic half-lives and linear pharmacokinetics. Also, almost 100% bioavailable as compared to the older generation. As compared to newer generation, high lipolysity, rapid permeability. So dose reduction is not required in renal impairment also, and immediate action. And only in hepatic dysfunction, 1/3 dose is required. So as compared to, these are levetiracetam, as compared to levetiracetam, no dose reduction. And as compared to levetiracetam, 1/3 in hepatic dysfunction. Now coming to comparison of brivetracetam with levetiracetam, it is target-based rational drug discovery program, discovery. And this was screening in audiogenic seizure mice. Available formulations, both are oral and IV. This was approved by FDA in 2016 and levetiracetam in 1999. So focal onset epilepsy, it is approved for age group more than 4 years of age, and levetiracetam more than 1 month old child. It can be used in focal, primary GTCS and myoclonic epilepsy. At present, brevetiracetam is used only in focal epilepsies. Mechanism of action, selectively binding to SV2A, as we have seen. Here it binds to SV2A, AMPA receptor inhibition is there, and high voltage calcium currents are also inhibited, which is not with brevetiracetam. But the affinity is very high to SV2A, 15 to 30 times. Drug entry, because of lipophilicity, it is very fast, rapid entry within minutes. Levetiracetam as compared to brevetiracetam, 1 hour. And it acts on P450. So drug interaction with rifampicin and combined OC pills plus older generation like phenytoin and carbamazepine is seen, not with levetiracetam. It has involvement with P450 enzymes. With liver failure, we have to adjust the dose, not with levetiracetam. Dose adjustment with renal failure is not required here, but with levetiracetam, obviously 1/3 we do it. Side effects, here we got to highlight, behavioral side effects are less, 3% only, but 10 to 15% with levetiracetam. So of every 10 patients, 1 to 2 patients we may get of behavioral side effects with levetiracetam. And cognition effect, similar to levetiracetam, what we have seen. And dose titration, switching from levetiracetam to brevetiracetam is 10:1 or without titration. Immediately we can shift. For example, a patient is on levetiracetam 500 and we have to shift to brevetiracetam. Immediately we can shift to 50 milligram from 500. Formulations oral available are 25, 50, 75, 100. Levetiracetam, all we know, IV 5 ml is equivalent to 50 milligram, which can be used same as levetiracetam over 20 to 30 minutes in 100 ml of solution. Mostly what we use is normal saline. Bioavailability is 100%. Time to peak is 2 hours and here it is 1 hour. Protein binding is high, 15 to 20%. Metabolism is primary metabolism, hydrolysis, hydroxylation. CYP2C19, 16% is seen, and it definitely involves the P450 enzymes, brevetiracetam. Half-life, mostly both have same half-life, but time for steady state is 2 days of repeated dosing. Here it is 24 to 48 hours, and clearance by kidney, both have clearance through kidney only, and dose adjustment not seen in renal failure. Here 50% dose adjustment. But in liver failure, we see 33% dose adjustment with brevetiracetam. And interactions, as we see, it is involving the P450 enzyme. So co-administration with rifampicin, OC pills, or then carbamazepine and phenytoin, we have to definitely have reduced drug dosages of these drugs. Now dosing, coming to dosage, adult doses 16 years and above, the recommended dose is 50 milligram twice a day, 100 milligram per day. That is minimal dosages. Based on individual tolerability and therapeutic dosage may be adjusted. Initially, we can start with 25 milligram twice a day and escalate up to 50 and go up to 100 twice a day, which is maximum 200 milligram per day. Pediatric patient, it is weight based. I'll come to it. And hepatic impairment, 1/3 dose adjustment has to be done. Adults, initial dose 50 milligram. Later on, we can go up to 200 milligram per day. Pediatric patients start with 25 to 50 twice a day. And maximum dosages can be up to 200, but has to be. This is above 50 kg. Less than 50 kg, it is 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg. This is the dose schedule. And maximum can be up to 2 milligram per kg, not more than that. And weight which is less than 20, definitely again up to 1.25 to 2.5 milligram per kg. Dose schedule is there. Now, globally, Brivaracetam is approved right now for focal seizures with or without secondary generalization in adults, adolescents, and children more than 4 years. So definitely it is used for focal onset epilepsy more than 4 years. I went through one trial right now while just seeing, even in status epilepticus, IV brivaracetam has proven good benefit, not used with as compared to levetiracetam also. And in status epilepticus, newer trials are coming up with brivaracetam IV. Adverse reactions, somnolence and sedation, dizziness, fatigue, nausea, and vomiting. Out of 800 used with brivaracetam, so percentage what we are seeing, mostly what we are seeing in somnolence and sedation and dizziness. Irritability, what we are seeing is quite less. So in this study, which was published, so I think to start slowly and escalate the dosages with a gap of 1 or 2 weeks would help to reduce these side effects also. Drug interactions definitely does not affect steady plasma concentration of levetiracetam, carbamazepine, lacosamide, lamotrigine. But very important drug interactions I would mention is ki rifampicin, carbamazepine, phenytoin, levetiracetam, and OC pills. So if we are giving AKT or rifampicin for any reasons, like in leprosy or tuberculosis, with brivaracetam, definitely it increases the concentration of rifampicin. So prescribers should increase brivaracetam dose, double the dose in patients requiring concomitant rifampicin. And carbamazepine, again, we may increase exposure to the active metabolites of carbamazepine. So carbamazepine dose reduction should be considered. Even with phenytoin used with brivaracetam, as both are acting on P450 enzymes, we have to reduce the dose of phenytoin when using with brivaracetam. And later on, it is worthwhile ki we can discontinue using phenytoin if we are using brivaracetam, and may add another drug with if it is required. There is no therapeutic advantage of using brivaracetam and levetiracetam together. So definitely, I think it may cause more of irritability and cognitive dysfunction. So better not to use this combination. And with OC pills, definitely we have to adjust the dosages of brivaracetam on the higher side. Pregnancy, no adequate data. So at present, we are not using in pregnancy. Lactation, definitely mothers on brivaracetam, still they have not seen much side effects, and breastfed infant from or underlying maternal conditions, lactation can be done. So clinical experience, there were some of 3 pivotal studies, and most of them were partial onset studies. What they have mentioned, the daily dosages were maximum 50 to 200. All studies were 2 weeks duration, followed by 3 months treatment, and 15,058 patients were seen, which received, most of them received, 1,100 received brivaracetam. Primary endpoint was responders for partial onset epilepsy. So what was seen was with brivaracetam 200 milligram, more than, so in a pooled analysis of these studies, no difference in efficacy was observed within the dose range when brivaracetam was combined with other drugs. But definitely the responders were very high, nearly 38.9% with 100 milligram. Mostly with not using higher dosages also, the responders were same. Nearly to 40% were seen as an add-on, being good responser to this drug and reduce in partial onset seizures. And seizure-free period of 3 months in clinical study was 2.5% with 50 milligram of brivaracetam, 5% with 100 milligram, and 4% with 200 milligram at 3 months duration. Now, in real world setting, what we see is 65.7% have benefited from brevetracetam, target dose being maximum of 200 milligram per day, and seizure free. 21% patient have been seizure free for 6 months with using of 100 milligram of brevetracetam. And they have used in generalized epilepsy, absence, myoclonic seizures also. So concluding, brevetracetam has efficacy for range of seizure types and syndromes in wide range, can produce positive outcome who have failed to with levetiracetam. And in Indian population also, there was a small study with 101 patients of brevetracetam used. And with 50 milligram per day, 39.7% or maybe 40% had reduction in seizure frequency, 46.8% with 100 milligram and 48% with 200 milligram. But with placebo, if you see, it is 20%. So definitely double is the seizure-free frequency by using brevetracetam, and responder rates were very high. Adherence was very high and complete seizure freedom was seen with good efficacy. So adjuvant use was very effective, well tolerated in patients with uncontrolled focal epilepsy. And lastly, in pediatrics, was proven to be helpful in focal epilepsy. Retention rates were high, no serious side effects, and can be used with syndromes also like Lennox-Gastaut and juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. And safety, less prevalent behavioral adverse effects seen with brevetracetam. This is my last slide. I think this I have put the slide. Okay. We have to see the cost also, because we are using is as an add-on therapy. If you see add-on drug, like 60 rupees it for levetiracetam also, and 200 milligram of brevetracetam also costs 60 rupees. While other add-on drugs, 42 rupees with oxcarbamazepine and lamotrigine, again 42 rupees, 40 rupees with topiramate, zonisamide 42, perampanel being very costly. So as an add-on drug, we have to choose our best drug with less side effects and better efficacy. So I think brevetracetam is here to stay. Now this slide I have prepared, this is the last slide. I think, how do I plan to use brevetracetam? This is what I have just thought of adding. If there is a focal and secondary generalized seizures, it can be as an add-on to a sodium channel blocker. If there is a genetic generalized epilepsy, as an alternative to valproate or as an add-on to another broad spectrum anti-epileptic drug, including valproate. If there are psychiatric adverse effects in levetiracetam responders, watch out for psychiatric adverse effects to brevetiracetam also itself. So it can come with brevetiracetam also. Woman of reproductive age group, wait. Let us wait. And patients presenting with multiple seizures per day. So they are refractory epilepsy. Rapid oral IV loading options, both now available. Loading dose can be 400 milligram, followed by we can give 200 healthy adult volunteers, or then we can go to 100 per day. And alternatives to phenytoin, clobazam, valproate, phenobarbital, and levetiracetam. We may try alternative for focal resistant epilepsy. Brevetracetam is here to stay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you for such an informative session. And I would like to, there are a few questions in the chat box. So shall I ask it right now?
Yeah.
Shall please, I wait please. For the...
Let them ask questions. Let Dr. Shah answer them.
Yes. So Dr. Purnima from Bangalore is asking, which is the safest anti-epileptic to use in children?
A difficult question, but safest, but most efficacious also the drug has to be for to be used in children. So broad spectrum anti-epileptic drugs, we see we are using levetiracetam. Sodium valproate is the most commonest used in children broad spectrum. We are using clobazam also. So brevetiracetam, we don't have any much experience. So let us see which may be the safest. But levetiracetam can be used, but we have to see for irritability. I think sir may answer this, ki irritability is also seen with phenobarbital, levetiracetam in children also, very commonly. And clobazam sometimes may act as a add-on to these drugs. But safer options are very difficult to answer. We have to see the type of epilepsy, any syndromic epilepsy are we treating, and then see which is the best and safest drug in such a child.
Okay, sir. The next question is from Dr. Partha Sarthi Hazra from Calcutta. He was asking about the indications for brevetiracetam.
Indication as per the guidelines is only for focal onset epilepsy, which has been approved. But over a period of time, all the indications which are for levetiracetam may be indicated for brevetiracetam, like generalized epilepsy, juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, absence, and focal onset epilepsy. So I think the drug is a broad spectrum drug, and we have to wait for all indications which we will be coming in trials.
Okay, sir. So this is the last question from Dr. Pawan from Aurangabad. He is asking, can brevetiracetam be used as first line? If yes, how was your experience?
I have been not using much, but I have started using, and hardly 3 to 4 of my patients are on brevetiracetam. Or previously, who were not tolerating levetiracetam, I had 2 patients which had been put on brevetiracetam since last 1.5 years. And after, now the generic drugs have come and totally brevetiracetam is off-label, off-patency into the market. The prices have come down. I think our experiences would grow of using brevetiracetam. And first-line drug, I think we can use as in focal onset epilepsy on patients who are on levetiracetam and are not tolerating because of cognitive side effects. We can directly switch over. But immediately starting every patient off and on has been marketed ki off brevetiracetam. No, we still it is an add-on drug and can be used as a first line who are not tolerating levetiracetam. So over a period of next 6 months to 1 year, lots of trials, lots of studies would come and lots of usages as per Indian scenario would be there. And we should be in a better position to answer these questions. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Shah sir, thank you so much for answering the questions. And I would like to invite Dr. Shukla to start his session. And sir, last question which just came was, can brevetiracetam be used in TLE?
Definitely we can use in TLE, but maybe as an add-on right now.
Okay.
As thank an add-on for those who are on levetiracetam, we can switch over. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. P.N. Shukla, sir.
Okay, I'll just start.
Yes, sir.
No doubt about that, that as Dr. Shah has talked about the drug, it sounds very, very high. And perhaps it will prove to be very good anti-epileptic drug. Especially, it will have an advantage over the levetiracetam, because levetiracetam has got its own very severe side effects alopecia, or I have seen a complete baldness in 2 patients. Complete, I was surprised to see. And at the same, the other thing is that levetiracetam cannot be prescribed to females, especially during the childbearing age. Even because it causes polycystic ovary disorder. I have seen PCOD in elderly females who are prescribed levetiracetam. So it should never be prescribed to females, nor a child, nor the childbearing age, nor the elderly people. So I'll just briefly talk about the psychiatric aspects of the epilepsy. And we all know that most of the patients of epilepsy of any kind, they are always prone to develop epilepsy. And most common, as we know, is that complex partial seizures, at least 50% of the complex partial seizure patients are prone to develop some or the other psychiatric disorders, and most commonly we observe the schizophrenia like psychosis. If we are not told about the epileptic part, that patient is suffering from any kind of epilepsy, and if the patient is presented to us, we will confuse it for pure schizophrenia. And this is why very, very important. Today only I had a very interesting case, a female 30 years old, and she was getting all those classical symptoms of schizophrenia, auditory hallucinations, persecutory ideas, abnormal behavior, insomnia, and refusing to take food or drug, etc. And refusing to take carry on the routine activities in the morning. So all those things were there. But then I asked them, we have to ask very categorically. Then they told me, yes, does it start spontaneously? They said, yes, it starts spontaneously. Only 5 days back, it has started. And usually it continues for about a week or 10 days, not more than that. And then suddenly she improves. And we know there are 6 points to diagnose complex partial seizure. Aura may be there, may not be there. Sudden onset, some alteration in the consciousness, certain psychomotor combine, and then spontaneous improvement. And most of the time, the patient remains completely amnesic about the whole episode. So was the case with this case. This lady actually got married 5 years back. Immediately after the first childbirth, she develops acute psychotic disorder. And she has been treated by many psychiatrists as a case of psychosis, schizophrenic illness. But when I took the history, I went for EEG, and EEG was perfectly like any epileptic. See here, all those most common disorder in the EEG. So I prescribed her today. For the first time, I prescribed this bevacizumab to her. So that's the first case today I saw. That means a case of classical complex partial seizure. Now let's go to the slide. So epilepsy is a disorder having cluster of abnormal seizures and have so on psychological, social, and neurobehavioral consequences. And psychiatric comorbidity in epilepsy is very, very common. If not epilepsy, a patient of epilepsy are prone to develop personality problems. They're extremely irritable, impulsive, etc. Epilepsy predisposes individuals to develop psychosis, mood disorder, depression and anxiety spectrum disorder, and background of genetic susceptibility. What I found that especially educated people, if they develop any kind of epilepsy, they really develop secondary depression because of their sickness. I'm sorry. So, which is cool. Epilepsy and psychiatric disorders. I'm sorry, if you can't say that. This is okay. Yeah. So patients who have epilepsy frequently have comorbid psychiatric disorders, and 20 to 30% of patients with epilepsy have psychiatric disturbances. It's a known phenomena. And 2 to 9% of the patients with epilepsy have psychotic disorders, and about half of the epileptic patients with psychosis could be diagnosed with schizophrenia. And the prevalence rate of psychiatric disorders in patients with epilepsy and the general population. Major depressive disorders, 10 to 10.7%. This is a control, and patients with epilepsy will be definitely high. So is the case with anxiety disorders, mood anxiety, and suicidal ideas. They are all high in epileptic patients. And we know, I've come across and seen many patients committing successful suicide when they are not given proper attention and proper treatment, antiepileptic treatment, as well as antidepressant treatment. So in spite of, in our country, what I found, and everybody, this must be the experience of every psychiatrist and other doctors, people do not take seriously our instructions. Drug compliance is extremely poor. In spite of repeated instructions, they do not give it more importance. That is the most important problem, a difficult problem to face with these people. Now, factors in the relationship between the epilepsy and behavioral disorders. Common neuropathology, genetic predisposition is very high, actually, we know it. Developmental disturbances, ictal neurophysiologic effects, inhibition or hypometabolism surrounding the epileptic focus, secondary epileptogenesis, alteration of receptor sensitivity, and secondary endocrinologic alterations. And variable, I'm sorry, it is not. Family history of psychosis. Patients who had a positive family history of psychosis were extremely susceptible to psychosis. So a genetic factor appears to be involved. It's a known phenomenon that psychosis runs in the generations. And in psychiatry, what we see that almost more than 50% cases of psychotic patients have definite positive family history. And age at onset of illness is very, very important. Patients with interictal psychosis showed a significantly earlier onset of epilepsy. And type of seizure, the existence of complex partial seizure may be strongly associated with interictal psychosis. It's a known phenomenon that in case of complex partial seizure, in spite of continuing the anti-epileptic treatment, they develop psychotic symptoms. So we have to be very careful and inform the family member that if at all they see some abnormal behavior in the patient, they should immediately contact us so that we can start antipsychotic drugs. Intelligence, patients with borderline intellectual functioning tend to develop psychotic symptoms relatively frequently. We know it very clearly that mental retardation is one of the most common causes of mental retardation is epilepsy. And epilepsy is very, very high in children in our country. And it goes, if people still are going to all those jharpun po jyada vishwas karte hain, aur jab thak jate tab phir hamare paas aayenge. Aur tab tak ke bachche ka mental retardation ho chuka hota hai. And we are helpless. We find ourselves helpless in that case. And the whole life is ruined if they don't bring the child in proper time to us. Now, asymmetry of amygdala and anterior segment of the hippocampus is one of the most important part of the brain, which is affected in neuroanatomical changes, which is observed in the patient of psychosis. In schizophrenia, it's known phenomena. And the role of hippocampal amygdala complex in pathogenesis of schizophrenia is also a very important phenomena. And smaller gray matter volume in the left and middle temporal gyri and left posterior superior temporal gyrus is also there. And rule of bilateral middle frontal gyrus or prefrontal cortex in the overt psychosis occurring with schizophrenia. And we know that the prefrontal part of the frontal cortex is the most important part of the brain, which is which performed all those intellectual or higher functions of the person is done by the prefrontal cortex of the brain, especially dominant lobe, right-handed person, left lobe. Superior temporal cortex and dysfunction of corollary discharge in auditory hallucination is a known phenomena. And we notice it in everyday practice. And the risk factors of developing psychosis, epilepsy, partial complex seizures, especially with temporal low foci. In our days, till I think late 80s or early 90s, this was known as temporal lobe epilepsy, TLE, what we used to call. Now, later on, the name has been changed to complex partial seizure. Because most of the time, the foci is in the, or focus is in the temporal lobe. And most of the time, the auras are like temporal lobe. They will hear some sound or some smell, burning paper or burning clothes. So that's why it was related to the temporal lobe. So to the presence of alien tissue, or maybe some alien tissue means some growth, small tumors or hematomas or abscess, etc. And the mesial temporal lobe ganglio gliomas may be there, which may cause this. And left-handedness, especially in women, they're also prone to develop this kind of problem. And the role of the neurologist in the psychiatric management of epilepsy, with epilepsy seizures. Yeah, we all know that the epilepsy is the domain of neurologist. It's a clear-cut demarcation. Our role comes only when the patient develops some or the other psychiatric problem. As we know that sometimes the patients present to us as a case of psychiatric problem. A complex paroxysm may come to us as a case of schizophrenia. And even a case of epilepsy, when they develop, they also develop schizophrenia-like disease or psychosis. And if we are not informed that he is a case of epilepsy, we may miss it completely. So we have to take history to know whether this psychosis is caused by epilepsy or it's an independent psychotic disorder. So are the symptoms related to anti-epileptic drugs? Is the onset of symptom associated with the remission and seizures in the patient who had previously failed to respond to the anti-epileptic drugs? So all these things are very, very important. And that is why I say that it's a domain of neurologists. Our role is secondary when they develop psychiatric illness only, otherwise no. How do we distinguish intellectual psychosis of epilepsy and the schizophrenia-like psychosis of epilepsy from schizophrenia? Well, this is not that difficult at all. Let me read this slide first. Lack of negative symptoms of schizophrenia, particularly flattening of affect and personality deterioration, better premotive personality, paranoid delusions, delusions of reference, more benign and variable cause. persistent intellectual psychosis. Yeah. The thing is that how to differentiate the periectal psychosis and of epilepsy and schizophrenia-like psychosis of epilepsy. First and foremost, history taking is very important, as I told you, that in between two episodes of complex paroxysms, the patient remains completely normal, asymptomatic. And even if he has psychotic symptoms, they are because of the epileptic part, abnormal waves in the brain. And as soon as the drugs are given, not only the seizures stop, even the schizophrenic illness also, symptoms also stop. But in spite of that, we have to add antipsychotic drugs, because the patient's abnormal behavior, then they won't be able to control unless or until we prescribe antipsychotic. But as soon as the patient improves, gradually we taper off and stop the antipsychotic drugs, unless or until he develops schizophrenic symptoms again in future. So criteria proposed for इस तरह सरकार नहीं सकती थी, दिखता नहीं। If you, I'm not able to read the, yeah. Okay. So criteria proposed for, oh, Stengo for a post-ictal psychosis. They have proposed some criteria like psychotic or other psychiatric symptoms occur after a seizure, or more frequently a series of seizures after a lucid interval or within 7 days of the seizures. So it varies from patient to patient. Sometimes the patient is brought to us with the psychiatric symptoms only, because people know that only the tonic and clonic seizures convulsions are the epilepsy. They don't know about the psychiatric symptoms could be a symptom of complex partial seizure or other partial seizures. They don't understand. So we have to take the history. Then only we'll be able to differentiate. And the event may be psychosis, depression, or elation, or maybe an anxiety-related symptom. And the event is time-limited, lasting days or rarely weeks, and no significant clouding of consciousness occurs. Well, that's a very well-known phenomenon. Usually, the complex partial seizure is hardly for a few minutes, but I have seen patients for more than a month. And really one thing very you must be knowing, famous Soviet Rus writer Dostoevsky, he was suffering from complex partial seizure. And he's told that whatever literature he has written during the ictal phase of complex partial seizure. And he used to say that, I don't know, how did I write this? So it's a, perhaps most of the people who know about this may be knowing this, but he has written all his stories and novels during the ictal phase. And his ictal phase used to last for more than a month and a half. In the beginning, nobody was ready to accept that a complex partial seizure may continue for more than a month. But I've seen not only one, many, many cases. I can give many examples. So it's a known phenomenon that it lasts very, very long time sometimes. Only the history, carefully taking history, can differentiate whether it's a schizophrenic illness or complex partial seizure. All those 6 points that I told you, sudden onset, alteration in the consciousness, some psychomotor components, spontaneous improvement, and maybe it may not be complete amnesia for the whole episode. Only 0.5% of the patient, even less than that, they remember some part of their epilepsy, and some remember everything. They know that I know everything, what is going on, but I cannot stop it. They say, I've seen many patients like that. Sorry, yeah. Post-ictal psychosis can be diagnosed as per following criteria given by Losdale and Tone. I think let's skip it. It's very lengthy, so I'll now cut short my. So status epilepticus and ictal abnormalities are treated in the same way as non-psychiatric epileptic events. That is a equally good thing. And post-ictal events are treated by improving seizure control. So it is very important. And fourth, normalization. Treatment of any of the psychosis of epilepsy should take into consideration the phenomena termed fourth normalization. Fourth normalization. So we have to treat the psychosis so that the patient improves fast. When the electroencephalogram in epilepsy psychosis, I'm sorry, the little part is missing. Yeah, bipolar affective disorder epilepsy is not that common. It's very, very rare. And depression is also that not that common. But two possibly exist. Depression is a reaction to the epilepsy, as I told you. Many patients develop depression because they have got epilepsy. And depression is a part and parcel of the epilepsy sometimes. And the reasons for clinicians' failure to recognize depressive disorder in a patient with epilepsy, patients tend to minimize their psychiatric symptoms for fear of being further stigmatized. Stigma is the most common cause of depression in these patients. And the clinical manifestation of the certain types of depressive disorder in epilepsy differ from depressive disorder in the last line I'm not able to read because it is okay. The risk factors for the development of depression in patients with epilepsy. In temporal epilepsy, it is sometimes very common. Vegetative auras and family history of psychiatric illness, particularly depression, and literary effects, which are controversial still. Anti-epileptic drugs leading to depression. Depression in epilepsy may also result from iatrogenic causes because of some pharmacologic drug or surgical procedures. Anti-epileptic drugs most frequently associated with iatrogenic depressive symptoms include, I'm sorry that I missed. Characteristics of the depression in the patient with epilepsy, fear neurotic traits, more psychotic traits, higher traits in state anxiety scores, more abnormal affect, chronic dysrhythmic disorder. It's a very, very complicated and lengthy thing, but I'll skip it. The symptoms of interictal dysphoric disorder in a patient with epilepsy. Dysphoria means severe agitation and depression and feeling of uneasiness and restlessness is known as dysphoria. On an average, the patients tend to have 5 of the following symptoms: depressed mood, energia, pain, insomnia, fear, anxiety, paroxysmal irritability, and loss of interest and mood there, and loss of concentration. Now, the anxiety disorder is common in patients with epilepsy because they know that they're suffering from this, especially in case of complex partial seizure. When they get aura, they become extremely anxious sometimes. Or in case of generalized epilepsy or grand mal epilepsy, when they get aura, they get extremely anxious and sometimes fearful. So anxiety is common in patients with epilepsy. So it's a known phenomenon. I'll just the treatment of anxiety disorder in epilepsy. Pregabalin used as an adjunct for partial seizures has been an effective, rapidly active, and safe treatment for generalized anxiety disorder. But any other drug from benzodiazepine group drug as an anti-anxiety can be prescribed if that drug doesn't work. So psychotropic effects of anti-epileptic drugs, carbamazepine, valproate, lamotrigine, and all those possible carbamazepine may have mood stabilizer. We know that all the anti-epileptic drugs are, we have got broad spectrum usage of anti-epileptic drugs in the field of psychiatry. We use them as not only as a mood stabilizer, but also as psychotropic drugs. They improve the mood of the patient and they maintain the patient's mood so that it does not go very high or very low. Gabapentin, pregabalin, and tigabin may have an anxiolytic effects. Teicosamide has no effect on depression or anxiety symptoms. And there is a risk of depression related to barbiturates and topiramate and possibly to phenytoin. And barbiturates are also known as to have some or other personality problems I've seen. So epilepsy and management of various psychiatric disorder. I won't go into depression. If the patient has got depression along with anti-epileptic drugs, we have to prescribe appropriate drug with the adequate dosage. Depending on the response, we have to change that dosage. And bipolar disorder are very, very rare in epileptic patients. But even then, we have to prescribe drugs for that. And as we discussed, all the anti-epileptic drugs have a mood stabilizing property also. So they will have both the property, anti-epileptic as well as controlling the bipolar disorder also along with, but we have to add some antipsychotic drug if the patient is in manic phase. epilepsy and management of various psychiatric disorders. Same thing, you know, they have to prescribe depending on the symptomatology or disease. We have to prescribe the drug. Suicide is whenever we get an indication of suicide, we are alarmed. We have to be very, very cautious and instruct the family members to be very careful. Do not leave the patient alone at home. And appropriate drugs should be prescribed to him if he is depressed or if he is psychotic. Even the psychotic patients commit suicide. And dementia is there, so we have to deal with the dementia also. I think it is the field of neurologists again. But if there's sometime the dementia patient also presents some psychotic features, so we have to treat them also accordingly. And then obsessive compulsive disorders may be seen, but they are extremely rare in case of epilepsy, and they will respond to anti-OCD drugs. But anti-epileptic drugs should continue with an appropriate dose that we have to explicitly inform the family members. And another thing that family members must be informed that medicine has to be given to the patient by one of the family members. Patients should not be handed medicine, whether it is a case of epilepsy or any psychiatric disorder. Most of the epileptic patients, I found they develop some or the other psychiatric disorder, mostly insomnia or early morning awakening or less sleep, hardly 3 hours sleep or 4 hours sleep. So we have to prescribe appropriate drug for that. Then we also should know, whether the patient has got depression or some other anxiety disorder which is causing him sleeplessness. Migraine has to be treated accordingly. I think the anti-epileptic drug itself has anti-migraine effect, so it will improve his condition. And psychosis has to be treated depending upon the symptomatology. I mean, whether it's a case of mania or whether it's a case of schizophrenia or any of the schizophrenic spectrum disorder. The relationship of psychotic symptoms to a particular ictal phase. So ictal phase of the occurrence of psychosis symptom. So all we have to see at what time the patient develops psychosis. Most of the time, if the patient is a case of grand mal epilepsy, so usually after epileptic few fits, they develop psychotic symptoms. Or in case of complex paralysis, the patient is brought to us with the schizophrenic symptoms or manic symptoms. And then we may get confused. So history has to be taken very, very clearly. The seizure threshold, lowering potential of the antipsychotic drug, this is very, very important. We know that all those drugs of phenothiazine group, the first generation of antipsychotic drugs, which we were using in 70s, no, there were no other drugs except the phenothiazine group and the haloperidol, butyrophenone group of drug. That's all. Only two drugs we had. Yeah, thiazine things were there, but it's a weak antipsychotic. So chlorpromazine, if given a high dosage, because I have used almost 3,000 of milligrams of chlorpromazine every day to a patient of mania and even the excited schizophrenic patients. And they were prone to develop epileptic fits. But in my life, I have never seen patient receiving 3,000 milligrams in a day, but they never developed epileptic fits. But it's known phenomena that they lower the threshold of epilepsy in these patients. Especially the clozapine is very, very dangerous drug. It's a comparatively new drug. Well, this was introduced for the first time as an antipsychotic in 1960 only. But because of there were so many deaths in patients, and they could not know what was the reason. So it was stopped from the market. Withdrawn from the market. In 90s, again, they started trying again this drug. Then they came to know that it develops leukopenia that causes agranulocytosis that causes death, sudden death. And there are many other side effects. So clozapine is a very important drug. When we prescribe that, when we go more than 10 milligrams a day, then we have to be very, very careful. That patient should, we should inform that if she gets some twitches or something, uneasy feeling, they should come to us immediately. thyroid nebulizer that it doesn't cause epilepsy. Phenothiazine, perphenazine is not available in your country. Olanzapine, no, it doesn't cause. Even the quetiapine doesn't cause. Piperazine, thiazonthine, zeprasamide, they're weak antipsychotics. They don't cause epilepsy, I know. And flufenazine, decanoate, it's available in the depot injection form. So it doesn't cause. Even haloperidol does not cause epilepsy because we have used almost 300, 400 milligrams in a day, but nobody developed epileptic fits or any kind of epileptic symptoms. Morindol is not available. Loxapine does not cause. Pimozide is is here, but it does not cause. Risperidone, polipiridone, and aripiprazole, they do not cause epilepsy. Let me tell you very clearly. I'm using these drugs since almost 30 years. Well, olanzapine, newer second generation drugs were introduced only in the late 90s. Now, the behavioral aspects of the anti-epileptic drugs, that is very, very important. Barbiturates is a very notorious drug in that condition, in that sense. It causes personality disorder, especially the children become irritable, restless, and a bit aggressive at sometimes. So, but I surprised even now the pediatricians are using barbiturate, where we have got better in drugs. I don't know why they still choose it. So depression, irritability, aggression, impaired cognition is another very, very important factor, which it should not be used, and hyperactivity. Carbamazepine, in our days, only 3 antiepileptics were available till 90s, till early 90s. They were phenytoin sodium, carbamazepine, ethosuximide, that's all. We had no other drugs. Valproate was introduced in late 90s, and other drugs came then later on in this 21st century, where we have been using those 2-3 drugs only. We're controlling all kinds of epilepsy with those 3 drugs only. And then this flimbamate, I think I have not used these drugs. Gabapentin is now it's a known drug. We are using it, behavioral problems in children. And phenytoin, we know it causes encephalopathy, depression, impaired attention, and other side effects, what Dr. Shah has already described. Lamotrigine is another drug which is cause insomnia and sometimes emotional lability. Levetiracetam, well, we know about that. Topiramate is a very good drug I have seen. Because I use it every now and then here, especially in my clinics, because it has an anti-epileptic property, but it also has a mood stabilizer property as well as psychotropic property. So it controls the patient behavior very nicely. So I very frequently use this drug. Valproate, as I told you, it's not prescribed to females. But it's a very good anti-epileptic, no doubt about that. And behavioral effects of new epileptic drugs, I think Dr. Shah has already talked a lot about that. So strategies for epilepsy with psychosis, establish a clear-cut diagnosis of bias settings, relationship with the ictal phase, and the management strategies of epilepsy psychosis. So not only what happens, there is some paradoxical thing. Once epilepsy is under control, psychosis the symptoms of psychosis develop. And if the psychotic symptoms are controlled, the epileptic fits improve, are developed. So we have to control the epileptic fits first. And then at the same time, we also prescribe antipsychotic drugs to control all those psychotic symptoms so that patient is under control and can be managed at home. So the end note, early recognition and management of the psychiatric disorder in patients with epilepsy is extremely important because it improves the quality of life and aids in better management. Otherwise, the whole family is rather ruined if it is not properly managed. They are already fearful about the disease. Over and above, the patient has psychosis or some other psychiatric problems, it becomes worse. So we have to treat both the things very efficiently. And as whenever we see a new drug in our armamentarium, we feel more confident to control or treat any disease. So it has again, we always welcome Nito. So this Vivrastam is also welcome. And I thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to talk to all of you. And thank you to Mr. Prashant and his colleagues. Thank you. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir, for elaborating on all the anti-epileptics and their indications. So I think in chat box already, Dr. Shah has answered most of the questions.
Yeah, yeah.
The two questions which came afterwards were from Dr. Imtiaz Srinagar. He's asking the location of how the location of seizure foci can impact on behavior and cognitive changes. This is his first question.
I think Dr. Shah would have been the better person. Let me tell you. In case of the so-called complex partial epilepsy, usually the focus is in the somewhere in the temporal lobe, which affects the behavior and higher functions of the person. That's why there is abnormal behavior, psychotic symptoms. So that's why focus is most of the time in the temporal lobe somewhere, especially nearby the amygdala and the hippocampus.
And the next question is, are ADHD and epilepsy interdependent? If yes, how to differentiate? What should be the ideal treatment option?
In ADHD?
Are they interdependent?
ADHD is in, yeah, that's right. We know that most of the children who are epileptic, they develop ADHD. It's one of the most common causes of ADHD. So ADHD, epilepsy has to be treated adequately. And then ADHD has to also be covered. The drugs are there. Now the treatment also differs from patient to patient depending upon the symptomatology. If the patient is extremely fidgety or extremely restless or extremely hyperactive, then we have to add drugs along with that. And then psychotherapy is equally important. We have to call the patient to our clinic, and one of our clinical psychologists will take care of the patient. And classically, he should be called every day for an hour at least, so that the clinical psychologist can spend time to him with the patient. Mm-hmm. And psychoeducation of the parent is very, very important, because they are also extremely, they are in deep trouble. When the parents see their child in a such dire situation in ADHD, they are extremely worried. What will be the future of the child? Whether he'll be able to study or not? So it is very, very important to psychoeducate the parents at the same time.
Next question is from Dr. Ramesh Delhi. He is asking, should we check psychological history of the patient before shifting to brivaracetam?
Why? If there is a patient, we must take the proper history, no doubt about that. Did patient have any episode of psychosis or abnormal behavior in the past? So we can get suppose any case of epilepsy, and there is abnormal behavior in the past, which continually for a few days or few weeks, and then he improved. It is meaningful for us. And then I will immediately like to go ask for EEG.
Yes, sir. His next question is that whether the epileptic EEG changes have any correlation with autism. His next question.
Autism is an entirely different thing. It has nothing to do with EEG.
But actually, I've also read that autism children have some EEG abnormalities.
Sometimes it does occur, no doubt about that. But the autistic patient may have epilepsy at the same time. Okay. And because of epilepsy, the autistic features may develop in child.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So I've covered most of the question, and thank you, Dr. Shah and Dr. Shukla, for your information. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And I would like to hand over the session to the host. Thank you for this presentation.
Mr. Deepak Nayak, sir, to thank the audience, chairperson, speaker, and the moderator.
On behalf of Health and You, I wish to thank Dr. P.N. Shukla for chairing this session and giving expert advice on psychiatric aspects of epilepsy. You know, when experts like Dr. Shukla speak, a lot of audience come. And today we have more than 100 attendance, 104 to be precise. So in these days when webinar attendance is less, for this webinar, because eminent personality Dr. P.N. Shukla was there, Dr. Shripal Shah was there, very nicely coordinated by Dr. Sonal Shukla, we had a great number of audience. Audience also asked very, very insightful questions to our speakers. So we thank Dr. Shukla for chairing the session and also giving his insights into psychiatry aspects of epilepsy. Dr. Shripal Shah for his expert advice on the new antiepileptic, especially brivaracetam, clearly differentiated between brivaracetam and levetiracetam, and where doctor needs to continue with levetiracetam, where they need to change to brivaracetam, clearly defined brivaracetam indications, especially when it is a new drug. So thank you very much, Dr. Shah. You went beyond the data that was there, also gave your experience. And I was candid enough to say that we have just started and there is enough experience that still needs to come. So thank you very much for your expert advice to our audience. And my dear doctors, today was a working day, Friday evening, heavy OPD day. In spite of that, you have come in large numbers, more than 100 numbers. And thank you very much for attending this webinar through DigiNeuro, coming to you from Health and You. Please take care of yourself during this COVID time, your near and dear ones. And once again, thank you very much. Continue to support Health and You, always together with you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to meet
Dr. Shah. There is one question someone has asked.
Yes.
Please go ahead.
I think someone should recently yes, I came. Ma'am, please, can you go through the question?
The last question is like he said, recently I came across to a young woman with abnormal behavior with history of epilepsy and had been started on phenytoin. Now clinical examination confirmed features of psychosis with paranoid delusion and auditory hallucination. Should I continue the phenytoin or shift her on other anti-epileptic drug? The question.
I think Shukla sir can take first.
I think anti-epileptic has to be given because the psychosis has been induced by the epilepsy. So to control epilepsy is a must. And at the same time, psychotic symptoms have to be controlled by giving appropriate antipsychotic drugs.
True. So which drug would you prefer, sir?
No question of stopping anti-epileptic drug.
Yeah, but do we continue the same drug or you feel we should change
over? I would like to change for a better drug than that. If he's a male patient, I would prefer to go for this brivaracetam.
She's a young female, sir.
Young female, yeah, we can
go ahead with brivaracetam then.
We can go with that to begin with 50 milligrams twice a day. And then anti-epileptic drugs, if he's a psychiatrist, he knows how to prescribe antipsychotic drug to a schizophrenic patient.
I totally agree, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Those of you who have come late and those of you who would like to see this webinar once again, tomorrow morning, this webinar will be uploaded on YouTube channel of Health and You, DigiNeuro. So you can have a look at this webinar once again. Tell to your people. So please subscribe to DigiNeuro channel of Health and You for many more webinars like this, more than 57 plus webinars on neurosurgery, neurology, and in neuropsychiatry. So thank you very much for attending. This is Deepak Nayak signing off from Health and You.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
on very short notice, you are very kind enough to join. No, so I'm very thankful.
Yes, sir, thank you so much, sir. Professor Shukla, sir, thank you so much. Dr. Sripal, sir, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.